Thank you for the introduction. So I will speak about modeling and data simulation in cardiac electrophysiology. It's a common work with many people, and in particular with Philippe. So cardiac electrophysiology is a study of the electrical waves with crushes over the heart and which trigger the muscle contraction. As you can see on this movie, no? Okay. Well, you cannot see. Sorry. Ah, yes. Okay. So the heart becomes depolarized and the contraction occurs. Okay? So in cardiac electrophysiology, we are interested in three potentials: the intracellular potential, the extracellular potential, and the transmembrane potential, which is the difference between both. And we are interested in different modeling scales. So first, we are interested in the evolution of the transmembrane potential over time in a cell. So here you have the depolarization, after there is a plateau phase, and after the repolarization. And we are also interested in the heart scale. I mean that the diffusion of the signal over the heart, as you can see here. The most common model in cardiac electrophysiology is a bidomain model, which is a nonlinear reaction diffusion system. In this part, you have the ionic terms, and which depends on many variables. And this variable verifies some hotkeys, and this allows to represent the cell scale. And after, you have different diffusion tensors. So it is a bidomain model because we have, you can write it with the NO, the extracellular potential, and the intracellular potential, or the transmembrane potential. There is existence and uniqueness of this model under some assumption, in particular some assumption on the ionic terms, because the ionic term is nonlinear. And there is also a simplified version, which is called the monodomain model. And it's when the intracellular tensor and the extracellular tensor are collinear. And with these equations, you just have the solution of VM, the transmembrane potential. So there are many issues in cardiac electrophysiology, and I want to present some of them during my talk. So first, concerning the modeling, we can look at the effect of the mechanical deformation on the electrical activity. So in fact, the bidomain models come from microscopic bidomain model, and in order to obtain a 3D model, you need an homogenization processes. And if you want to integrate a new effect and to improve your model, you need to restart all the processes with the homogenization or with the Michaud theory. So I won't speak about that during my talk, and for the sake of simplicity, we will neglect this effect in that follow. Okay? Another issue in modeling is the particularity of the atria. So here you have the heart, and the inferior part are the ventricle, and the superior part the atria. And the atria are very thin. And that's why we want to derive a bidomain surface model. And for that, we use the asymptotic analysis. So it will be the first part of my talk. And after, I will speak about data assimilation, because when you have a model, after you want to adapt this model to each patient. And for that, you need to use the data which are available. And it will be the second part of my talk. So first, the atria. So the atria are very thin and only appears as a surface in medical imaging. So that's why we want to derive a surface electrophysiological model using some asymptotic analysis. And the second objective also is to decrease the computing time. So for that, I recall the bidomain model. And the main difficulty comes from the fact that the heart has a fiber architecture, and this fiber are preferred direction for the diffusion of the signal. So this means that we can the intracellular tensor and the extracellular tensor are decomposed into two parts. So the first part is the homogeneous part. You have a propagation in all the direction, and you have a propagation along the fiber. And here, tau is a unique vector which is parallel to the local fiber direction. And so, as already said, the atria are very thin, but the fiber across the thickness of the atria can vary, can rapidly vary. So this means that we want a surface model able to consider some 3D aspects with the variation of the fiber. So it is the main difficulty of this work. That's why I will focus on the asymptotic analysis of the diffusion problem. Okay. So first, I consider a diffusion problem, and here you have the weak form. And I need some assumptions on the variation of the fiber across the thickness. So I will consider here that tau is a local direction of the fiber. So I will call tau zero, which is the mean direction of the fiber, and I will assume that I have a linear variation of the fiber inside across the thickness. So this means that a vector in the fiber can be decomposed into two parts. So the first part, where you have the decomposition on T0, so the mid-surface direction, and along the orthogonal of tau zero. You can see that if theta equals to zero, this means that there is no variation across the thickness. So everything are on T0. And more theta is important, more you have to consider the direction on the orthogonal of T0. So we did an asymptotic analysis inspired from Shell theory. And for white, we consider an asymptotic decomposition of U and V, as you can see here. And there is existence and uniqueness of a solution. And this solution depends on epsilon, where epsilon here is the n-dimensional small parameter. So in fact, it is the thickness on the diameters of the surface. And when you want to derive a bidomain surface model, the first steps consist in identifying a limit problem. So for that, we just keep the first terms in the asymptotic development. So, and you can see that you have two terms. So the first term is the homogeneous term. I mean that you have a propagation in all the direction. And the second term, which is here, is the anisotropic term. So as you can see, there is a part on, it is a decomposition along the basis tau zero and the orthogonal of tau zero. And you have some parameter which depends on the angle theta. And if you look, when theta equals to zero, E zero equals to one. So this means that everything is along T zero. And more theta is important, more this second part will be important. And the second step consists in proving some convergence theorem. So I don't want to do the demonstration today, but if you are interested, everything is here. So after, we can propose a bidomain model by applying the result of the derivation of the diffusion terms. So here you can see the classical bidomain model, and the diffusion tensor are decomposed into two parts, where here you can see the interest of the asymptotic analysis, because you know that the tensor will be you have the propagation in the basis to zero and the orthogonal of to zero. So all the simulations that I will show today are obtained with the finite element library called Felice, which is developed at INRIA. So it's a finite element library, and the objective of this library is to contain all the tools needed to perform simulation of complex cardiovascular models. I mean that electrophysiology, fluids, and solid mechanics, and also all the coupling phenomena between these phenomena. So it's in C++ and it is based on the PET-C library. So here is the first simulation that I want to show you. So on the left, you have the 3D bidomain model, and on the right, the asymptotic bidomain model, and you have three snapshots. So we cannot see a difference between both, and if we look the error in L2, the error is inferior to 2%, so this means that it's a very good result. And in terms of computing times, the ratio is very important. So this means that this first test validates this strategy. And I want also to show you another first test in order to show you how the asymptotic analysis is important. So here it's a very classical benchmark in cardiac electrophysiology is when the spiral waves appear. So the idea is that you have a signal, so here's the depolarization. After you have the repolarization, and you can imagine that there is a pathological area here which triggers a new signal. And the repolarization is a refractory phase, so this means that if the heart is not repolarized, you cannot imply a new stimulation. So that's why here, this new stimulation will go on the left, as you can see, and after, you can have some spiral waves. So I will show you on a video, and you have the bidomain surface model on the left, the 3D model on the right, on the right, you have the 2D naive model. So this model is when you, if you do not know the asymptotic analysis and you say, okay, I have a linear variation of the fiber, maybe I can just consider the fiber which is in the mid-surface and apply it across the thickness. You see here that this naive model is not able to follow the 3D bidomain model. So this means that we need the asymptotic analysis if we want to integrate some variation across the thickness in the model. Okay, so after we can do some realistic simulation. So here I have a mesh of the atria. Here you have the fiber at the endocardium, so the inner surface, and here the fiber at the epicardium. And you have here a very realistic simulation of the atria. And this simulation is in very good adequacy with 3D modeling studies where everything is simulated. And so I will conclude the first part of my talk. So we have a bidomain surface model which is adapted to thin cardiac structure, as for example the atria. With that, we can obtain a full electrophysiological model and by coupling the atria with the ventricles. And we can also, for example, apply some electrocardiograms. So I don't speak about that today, but this is a way to validate also all the strategy. And there are many perspectives, as for example, obtain an asymptotic electromechanical model. And this is also very, it is a difficult subject because the fiber are also a preferred direction for the contraction. So this means that you have to develop a surface mechanical model able to consider the variation of the fiber across the thickness. And the last, and also, for example, the effect of the mechanical deformation on the electrocardiograms. And the last point, which is very important, is that when you have very realistic simulations, as you can see here, we want, after that, to adapt this simulation to each patient. So it will be the second part of my talk. So the objective is to personalize a model, typically for a patient, and the idea is to give this information to the doctor to help him for the prediction, to provide a diagnostics and prognostic assistance. So the starting point of this second part is the very realistic simulation of the full heart, as you can see here. And the data, okay, so when you want to do some data assimilation, you have to choose the data that you want to assimilate. So here we will consider the depolarization map. So this means that, in fact, we know where is the front at different instants. So we don't know, okay, so here you have a depolarization time. So this means that Here, for example, you know that it was different at 5 milliseconds, for example. But you don't have any information of the value of the transmembrane potential here. You just know that the front is here. So here it's a depolarization map of the atria, and here a depolarization map of the ventricle. And the objective is to propose an effective strategy for performing estimations with data which are in form of level sets. Okay? So first, how obtain the front level set data? You have some image, which are CT or MRI, and you can, with the image, you can build the heart and the torso geometries, okay, as you can see here. And you have also some electrode vest, which in fact record the multiple surface potential that you have on your on the torso. And with that, you can build a body surface potential, as you can see here. Okay, so with the geometry and with the body surface potential, you can use computing inverse problems in order to find the map of the electrical activation. So this is also a very difficult inverse problem, but I don't want to speak about that today. I will focus on this part. I mean that I consider that someone already did these inverse problems, and I have the depolarization map, which are on the atria and on the ventricle. Okay? So this means that I consider that I have the depolarization map, as you can see here. So you can see here like that, but also this means that in fact you have the information where is the contour over time. And you have your model, which is the B-domain model, and we want with that provide some patient-specific simulation. So there are many work on that in the literature, and but in many cases, people don't use the B-domain model, and they simplify the B-domain model in order to have, for example, a level set equation. And in this case, of course, the solution U is the same as your data, so it's easier to assimilate it. So the idea is really to use a sequential estimation on the complete B-domain model. It's our objective. So that's why I will try to explain first what is a sequential method. So the idea is that you have a target model. So R here is your model. It can be nonlinear. And U, zero, is your initial condition. And theta are your parameters. And you assume that you have an a priori on your initial condition and on your parameters. Okay, but you have also a nano part. And if you do the simulation just with the a priori part, you know that you cannot, it's not the same simulation, and you did a mistake. And you don't know the solution of the target model, okay? But you have some information which are the observation. In your case, for example, we do not know the solution of the electrophysiological model with the full initial condition and theta, but we know where is the front at different time, okay? And we want to use this observation in order to adapt, to correct this model. So the idea consists in adding a terms like that, a gain terms, where D is a discrepancy. So the idea of D is to compare the observation that you have here and the solution of your observer model, okay? So this can be something very simple or something very complicated. In your case, it's something which is complicated because the observation are the position of the front and U is a solution of a reaction diffusion model, okay? And after, you add a gain operator here on the decoupency, and the objective is to decrease the decoupency over time, okay? And okay, so this will correct the state of this of your system. And if you want also to estimate some parameters, and this is the objective, because if you estimate the parameters for a patient, after you can do some prediction. The idea is to add a dynamic on the parameter. I mean that here the parameters are constants, and you will add a dynamic of them, and to the model part of that will be a gain operator, which is different from the gain state in this case, apply also to a discrepancy. And the objective is to have u hat and theta hat, which tends to u and theta over time, over simulation time. Okay? So this strategy is decomposed into two parts. So first, find a state observer for zero action diffusion model, and after, extend to parameter observer. So the second part is something which is classical, which is presented in this article. And as you can see, if you have a state estimator, you can directly extend it to a parameter observer. So the first point is a difficult point for us. We need to build a state observer. Okay, that's why in that follow, for the moment, I just will consider that I have an error in the state. So, for example, in my initial condition. Okay, so I have a reaction diffusion model, as you can see here. So it could be the p-domain model, the monodomain model, or over reaction diffusion model. And I can define which is the threshold of u. I mean that if u is superior to this constant, this means that it is depolarized. And if it is inferior, this means that it is not depolarized. And we can define with that an omega u hat, as you can see here. And this means that we can define also a level set, which will be called phi u hat, which is associated with omega u hat. And there is an Ekonal equation which is verified by phi u hat. So this means that when you have a reaction diffusion model, you can find a level set, an Ekonal equation or a level set equation verified by the level set which is defined with the solution of your reaction diffusion model. Okay? So this is something which is very classical, and the idea consists in doing an asymptotic analysis along the direction of the front, so here, C1, and you obtain this Ekonal equation, which is presented here. Okay, so there is an asymptotic relation between your reaction diffusion model and the Ekonal equation, which is here. And so first, why we decide to do that? Because if we look what happens in image processing when you want to segment an object, you have a level set, so here in red, and an object in black, and you want to segment it, and this means that for that, you need to compare two fonts. And in fact, we have the same problem. I mean that we have the font which is the font of your target, so for example, here it is in blue, okay? And you have the font of the observer, of the solution of your observer model, which here is in red. And the idea in image processing consists in minimize an energy. Okay? So this energy is decomposed into two parts. So first, the regularization terms, for example, the minimization of the perimeter or the surface or the volume. Okay? And some data terms. And the data terms allow to compare these two fonts. Okay? The idea is that with the blue font, you can define an object with a value inside and a value outside. Okay? So this is ZU, the observation. And you can compute C1, which is the average of ZU inside the red font. Okay? And you can define also C2, which is the average of ZU outside the white font. Okay? And this is a way to, if you minimize this, you will minimize the difference between your two fonts, which are here. After, in image segmentation, so they have an energy, they want to minimize this energy, and they just use a gradient projection method, as you can see here. And this means that you have here your level set, which represents the green font in the previous movie. And you see that here you have the regularization terms. I don't want to speak about these terms today. And here you have the data terms. Okay? So our idea was to use the Ekonal equation that we have with the reaction diffusion model, so which is here, and add the data terms which come from we confirm image segmentation, as you can see here. And this give us a state observer for the Econal equation. Okay? So here you have your model, and here you have your data terms will correct your model over time using the observation. Okay? And in order to propose a state observer for the reaction diffusion model, we do the inverse asymptotic analysis in order to find the terms that we have to put here if we want to find the terms which is here with the same asymptotic analysis but for the model. Okay? And we obtain this state observer. And we can simplify it by seeing that a level set which is adapted to U is just U minus the threshold. Okay? And if you look with terms, so here we have the reaction term, here you have the diffusion terms, and here you have your observer terms. So first you have a gained parameters, after you have a Dirac here, so this means that you will just apply your corrections on your front of the you had, and this will give you the direction. I mean that are you in late or are you in advance? Okay? So we prove that these terms is the observer terms is a stabilizing terms. I mean that, okay, so we have U, which is the solution of the target model, and you have U hat, which is the solution of the observer model. And you can compute the error model, which is the difference between both. You look, and you look the energy of this error model. And you want that this new terms, the observer term, decrease the energy of your error model. So we prove it, and we just have to verify a contrast condition, which is something which is very known in image segmentation. I mean that here, for example, you cannot segment the banana because the contrast condition is not verified. So okay. So this means that we are in the same case. I mean that when we have the front, we have to define an object with really a value inside and another value outside, which are different. Okay. So first, so now I will show you an illustrative example in 1D. So in red here, you have the target front, okay? And here in blue, you have the observer front. So this means that here I did an error in the initial condition. So there are the both initial condition. And I made a mistake. I switched the initial condition and I delayed it, okay? And we can see that the observer model is able to track the target's model and to correct your error over time. Okay? And if we look, for example, in a surface case for the atria, so I consider that I have a mesh, a geometry of the patient using CT or MRI. I have the fiber of the patient, okay? And I have the data, I mean a depolarization map, as you can see here. And for example, if I did a small error in the initial condition, this means that I move the position of the sinus node, okay, which is the natural pacemaker of the heart, just like that. I can correct this error using the observer. So you can see that here, the solution of the reaction diffusion model will trigger your front, which is in green, okay? If we just look what happened for the front, so I have three fronts here. First is the no observer. I mean that I consider that I have the wrong position of the sinus node and I don't correct this model. And you can see that the blue front, which is the observer front, will quit the green front in order to go to the right front. Okay, so this is a very good result. And after, if you want to estimate some parameters, you can use the automatic strategy. I mean that when you have a state parameters, you can directly extend it to a joint state and parameter observer. So the procedure is you have an observer, a state observer, which is here, and you will hide a dynamic, on your parameters like that, okay? So in this simulation, we use some ROKF algorithm. So the idea is that you have your solution at time tn, And you will do a sampling, which means that you will launch P particles in parallel. Yeah, and so first you will collect this state. So first you will have your prediction, so using your model, so you will obtain a state and parameter prediction. After that, you will do state correction using your observer terms. And after, you can use all the sampling that you are here in order to build a parametric correction. Okay? And after, you can restart. And the advantage of this strategy is that all the particles can run in parallel. And they are just to communicate at the end here in order to build your new state and your new parameter. Okay, so here it's also an illustrative example in 1D. So in this case, I will consider that I do not have an error in the initial condition, okay? So, but I have an error in my parameter, which is sigma m here, which is the diffusion parameters. And as you can see in green here, you have the solution if you do not correct the parameter. And here you have the evolution of the parameter. So the objective is to find the parameter which is equal to the red line here. And you can see that it works perfectly. Okay? So now, if I have an error in my initial condition and an error in my parameter, and I use the same strategy, it doesn't work. Of course, because here you have, I switch the initial conditions. So this means that here it is in advance and here it is in late. So, and in this case, the observer is not able to know if he has to decrease the diffusion parameter or if he has to increase the diffusion parameter. So one strategy, if you want to circumvent this limitation, is to say, okay, so first I will just correct the state. I mean that I will correct the error that I did in my initial condition. And after that, I will, sorry. And after that, I will estimate my parameters, as you can see here. And this strategy works. We can also imagine other strategy where, for example, during a first cardiac cycle, you estimate the initial condition. Okay, and after, with your estimated initial condition, you can estimate your parameters, okay? So, I just want now to show you a limitation of this observer, is when you have two fronts, for example, for the target, so you have two red fronts here, and just one, only one front for the observer. And as you can see, the observer is able to correct the left front, but you cannot track the second front. Okay, so this is the limitation of this first observer, and it could be a problem when you have some atrial fibrillation. So I mean that here you have a pathological area which trigger a new stimulation, and you have these spiral waves using the same problems. Using the refractory phase of the repolarization. And this is a limitation, because if you are not able to track this new front, you cannot imagine to have a realistic simulation. So the idea consists in, say, in the first observer, we have this energy, and we compute, in fact, we have computed a shape derivative of this energy, and we have the observer term, which is defined like that. So you have your energy, which comes from the image processing. You can define a shape derivative, and you had this shape derivative as an observer. Okay? So this was the first strategy. So now the idea is to circumvent the limitation of this shape observer is to say, okay, I want to have a new front. So this means that I want to have a change in the topology of my front. So the idea is just to use the topological derivative. So I have my energy here, and I can define a topological derivative, and say, okay, here I have the shape-based observer, and I can add the topological observer. Okay? And now, so if here it's the simulation that I showed you previously. And now, with the topological observer, I can detect a new front which will appear. So this will be very useful when we have some atrial fibrillation. So here, for example, it's a case where a new front will appear here. So I will put a delay in before applying the observer in order to show you how it works. So first you have your no front which appear, and the topological observer is able to detect it, as you can see in this movie. And if we look the front, you see that at the moment you the queen and the red and the blue front are insane. Sorry. Okay, so now to conclude, I want to speak about the two CEMAX projects where I am involved. So the first one is to use. Okay, so we did some realistic case for the atria, and now we want to prove that it works also with real data. And we decide also to use another model just in order to show that it's not depend on the model that you use. If you have a front, if you have a reaction diffusion model, it will work. And here it's a bilayer model, so the idea is that you don't have a bidomain model, just a monodomain model, but you will consider two meshes and two layers of fiber. One is the inner surface and one is the outer surface, okay? And you have a coupling terms between your solution at the outer surface and your solution at the inner surface. And we will use some real data which come from the LIRIC Institute at Bordeaux. So this is the first CEMAX project. And the second one is to say, okay, it works, in fact, our observer works when you have a reaction diffusion model and when you have data which give you the position of the front. And in fire propagations, they do not really have a reaction diffusion model, but they have a level set equation, which is here. And in fact, it works also because you have a front and you want to target the front of your target, to track the front of your target. And so this is the objective of this second CEMAX project. And we want to apply it with real data. So here you can see the temperature, which define a front, okay, so an hydrogen front. But we can use some strategy to define a front in this case. And here is the first simulation that we have obtained with real data in fire propagation. So in blue, you have the solution of the observer model without the observer term, okay? In red, you have the front that you will correct over time, and in yellow, you have the observations. And you can see that we are able to follow, to track the yellow front. So it's a very promising result. So thank you for your attention. And if you have some question.
Okay, I have just one quick question. So, do you have any other ideas of application for this kind of observer for other modeling applications?
Yes, for example, it works also with some model which are transport model. Because if you have when you have a front and when you have some data which are position of the front, so for example, you can use it with a tumor model where you have the evolution of the tumor as a, which is done by a transport model. And you have the position of the tumor using CT or MRI, and you can assimilate it. So, yes.
Other questions? Okay. Thank you very much, Annabelle.
Thank you.